Assalamu alaikum students. From today I am going to start a brand new mathematics course for you, and that is vector and tensor analysis. And the book that I am going to follow throughout this course is Vector and Tensor Analysis by Professor Dr. Nawazish Ali Shah. This is one of the popular books on vector and tensor analysis recommended by various universities. Dear students, vector and tensor analysis have so many applications in fluid dynamics, differential geometry, general theory of relativity, and various other fields of science and engineering. Vector analysis provides a precise notation for equations which result from geometrical and physical problems. And tensor analysis is the generalization of vector analysis, which provides a compact way of writing complex geometrical and physical relationships. So all the physical quantities can be classified as either scalars or vectors. So in order to describe scalar quantities, we need only magnitude, whereas vector quantities require both magnitude and directions to be specified. Dear students, our first chapter of vector and tensor analysis is algebra of vectors. Okay, so in this first lecture, we are going to study the basic algebraic properties on vectors. Vectors can be represented in two ways, geometrically as well as analytically. So there are two aspects of vector representation, and we will discuss each aspect of vector representation in detail. So our today's lecture is based on geometrical representation of vectors. So we will define the basic algebraic terms based on the geometrical representation of vectors. And in the next lecture, we will define the same algebraic properties based on the analytical representation of vectors. Okay, so now let us start with the geometrical representation of a vector. So geometrically, as you already know, we represent a vector by a directed line segment. Okay, so represented by a vector is represented by a directed line segment. Like this. So we have a line segment. For example, let us call this line segment, directed line segment, as OP. So here this OP is a directed line segment. So this line segment has a specific direction being shown by this arrowhead. Okay. So geometrically, this directed line segment represents a vector OP. And here, this point O, which is the tail point of this directed line segment, this is called the initial point of the vector. Okay, so here, O is the initial point. And this P, terminal point. And we denote this vector OP by this symbol OP arrowhead. So there is an arrow on the name of the vector which shows that it is a vector, so OP vector. So this is vector OP. Okay. Now the length of this line segment OP gives us the magnitude of this vector. Okay. So here magnitude of the vector OP is simply the length of the line segment OP. And it is also called the norm of the vector. So norm of the vector OP. Okay. So magnitude, length and norm, these are all the same things. Okay. So the length of the directed line segment gives us the magnitude or the norm of the vector. Okay, so now let us talk about equal vectors. So two vectors are said to be equal if they have the same lengths or magnitudes and the same directions. Okay, so two vectors with the same magnitudes and directions are called equal vectors. Okay, so let us suppose a vector A, this is our vector A, and we have another vector B like this. Now if these two vectors have the same lengths and the same direction, then they are equal. So here vector A is equal to vector B. Okay, so two vectors are said to be equal if they have the same lengths or magnitudes and the same directions. So here you can see that we can shift any vector without changing its magnitude and direction. Okay, now let us talk about the negative of a vector. So negative of a vector. Okay. So let us suppose a vector, so let A be a vector, then another vector whose magnitude is the same as that of A, vector A, but has an opposite direction is called negative of vector A. And the negative is denoted by negative vector A. Okay, so if we have a vector A like this, so this is our vector A, then another vector with the same length is that of this vector but with the opposite direction like this. This vector, another vector, then this will be the negative of the vector A. So we will write it as negative of the vector A. Okay, then there is another term regarding vectors, and there is a unit vector. So what is a unit vector? So a unit vector is a vector whose length or magnitude or norm is 1. Okay, so a vector with a unit length or magnitude or norm is called a unit vector. So a vector with a unit magnitude. Unit magnitude means 1. Is called a unit vector. Okay. So if we have a vector A, like again like this, so this is our vector A, then this vector may not have a unit length or unit magnitude. Okay, so in order to obtain a unit vector in the direction of this vector or a unit vector parallel to this vector, we divide this vector by its magnitude. So a vector, so a unit vector in the direction of this vector A will be equal to this vector divided by the magnitude of the vector, and the unit vector is represented by A hat. So this is hat means that, so here hat shows that it is a unit vector. Okay, so in order to write a unit vector in the direction of a given vector, divide that vector by its magnitude. Okay, so now we will define a null vector or a zero vector. Okay, so a zero vector, or we also call it a null vector. So a zero vector is a vector whose magnitude is 0. A vector with 0 magnitude and no specific direction is called a zero vector or null vector. Okay, so a zero vector doesn't have any specified direction, and its length is also 0. So geometrically a zero vector is represented by a point only. So it is represented by a single point. Okay. We can denote a zero vector by zero vector, but this vector will have no specific direction and it will be represented by only a single point, not by a directed line segment. Okay, now we will discuss the algebraic operations of addition and subtraction on vectors. addition of vectors. Okay, so let us suppose a vector A like this. This is our vector A, and another vector B. Then, in order to add these two vectors, we follow a rule called head to tail rule. So, there is a head to tail rule. So, according to this rule, we take the vector A and place the tail of vector B on the head of vector A. So, here is our vector A. Now, we take this vector B and place its tail on the head of vector A like this without changing the length or direction of the vector B. This is vector B. Now, the sum of A and B will be another vector which starts from the initial point of A and ends at the terminal point of B. So, here this vector. So, this vector is A plus B. So, here as you can see that now there is a triangle formed by the vector A, B and their sum. Okay, so this method of vector addition is called triangle law. Okay, so this is triangle law of vector addition. Okay, so here again we can describe this thing in another way, like we can translate this vector B over here. So, again, this is our vector B. So, here if we shift this vector over here, so it doesn't change, we don't change its direction and length. So, this is the vector B, and similarly, we can translate this vector A over here, like here. So, this is our vector A. So, here you can see that now a parallelogram is formed. And here the sum of the vectors A and B is given by the diagonal of this parallelogram. Okay, so here suppose we get a parallelogram, let's name it O P Q R. Okay, so here now the sum is given by the diagonal of the parallelogram O P Q R. Okay, so this is called the parallelogram law of vector addition. Okay, so parallelogram law of vector addition. So in parallelogram, the sum is given by a diagonal of the parallelogram. Okay, so this is the addition of vectors. So geometrically, in order to add two vectors given in their geometric forms, okay, so we use head to tail rule. So, we take one of the vectors and place the tail of the second vector on the head of first vector, and their sum is the vector which starts from the initial point of first vector and goes to the terminal point of the second vector. So, this forms a triangle, and we can also see this sum is a diagonal of the parallelogram. So, this way of vector addition is called a triangle law of vector addition or parallelogram law of vector addition. Okay, now we will talk about the subtraction of two vectors, how we subtract a vector from another vector. So again, we suppose two vectors. So let A and B be two vectors. Okay, then their difference A minus B is given by A plus negative of B. Okay, so subtraction is again a kind of addition, but the addition with the negative of another vector. Okay, so A minus B is the same as A plus negative of B. Okay, so A vector minus B vector is equal to A vector plus the negative of B vector. Okay, so in order to subtract a vector from another vector, okay, so we take the negative of the second vector and add that vector to the first vector, like we did in our vector addition. So suppose here we have our vector A again. So this is our vector A and this is our vector B. Okay. So to find A minus B, so we reverse the direction of vector B. That is, we take the negative of this vector. Okay. So what is the negative of this vector? So this vector is negative of B. Negative of B. So now we add this vector to this vector A. So now in order to add these two vectors, this vector and this vector, again we use head to tail rule. So we take our vector A. So this is a vector A. And we place the tail of the second vector, which is minus B over here, like here, without changing its length or direction. So this is our vector minus B. Now, according to the triangle law, so this vector, which starts from initial point of first vector and goes to the terminal point of the second vector. So this vector here, so this is A minus B. Okay. So now we will talk about another algebraic operation on vectors, which is scalar multiplication. So scalar multiplication. Okay, so again suppose, so let A be a vector and M be a scalar. Scalar means a number, a real number. So A is a vector and M is some scalar or real number. Then the vector M times A vector. Okay, so if we multiply that scalar with the vector A, then we get the vector M times the vector A. So this is again a vector. Then the vector M times A is called a scalar multiple of the vector A. So basically this vector M times the vector A, it scales up or scales down the vector A. So if M is positive, okay, then this vector has the same direction as that of vector A. And if m is negative, it has opposite direction. So in this scalar multiple, if m is some positive number, then m times a vector will have the same direction, a is the direction of a, and if it here m is negative, its direction will be opposite to the direction of a. And here, if m is greater than 1, it scales up the vector a. And if m is less than 1, it scales down the vector a. Okay. Now here the magnitude of this vector m times a, so we represent the magnitude by this symbol. So magnitude of this vector will be equal to m times the magnitude of a vector. And here, so the scalar multiple of the vector a will be a vector which is always parallel to the vector a. Okay, so here m times the vector a, which is scalar multiple of a, is a vector parallel to a. So scalar multiple of a vector is always parallel to that vector. Okay, now we will define parallel vectors. Okay, so let us suppose two vectors. So let A and B be two vectors then A and B are parallel if one of the vectors is a scalar multiple of the other vector. That is, if A is equal to, the vector A is equal to m times b vector, so A is a scalar multiple of b, or b is a scalar multiple of a, then the vectors A and b are said to be parallel vectors. Dear students, in today's lecture, we studied the geometrical aspect of vectors. So we studied the geometrical aspect of representation of vectors. And we studied some basic algebraic properties on vectors using their geometrical representation. And in the next lecture,